Good evening and welcome to Tinkering with Etkelar. To continue the current trend and to get a few packages out of my hallway, I have decided to finish the next component for my retro hi-fi system, the record player. Since decent ones are highly sought after, especially by DJs, even used models can reach way beyond the 1000 euro mark. Yikes! I kept an eye out before Christmas though and came across a 100 euro option. Much more my price range. It arrived in pretty good condition overall, just a few scratches and minor dirt on the case really. But you know me by now. Some details up front. The player is branded as a Blaupunkt XQ-240. Blaupunkt is, or rather was, a German company that made hi-fi components for cars and home systems. But here's the thing. To my knowledge, they never made their own record player. That part got outsourced to a company that had a division that made quite good record players. Yes, this is actually made by Technics. You can see the family lineage if you squint just about right. Now for the features. It is a direct drive model. That means the platter is actually the hub of the motor. A three-phase synchronous motor, that is. No belts or gears in between, and thus perfect quartz control speed. It doesn't get any better than that. The pitch control, which is really just a manual speed adjustment, allows fine-tuning of playback speed. To confirm the correct speed, it has a strobe light and mirror patterns on the platter. It is what's called a fully automated player, push-button living. The only manual input it needs is the diameter of the record. As you can see, that fully automated control was pure mechanics. All these levers and springs are driven off the main turntable motor, and that white gear uses a cam to operate the mechanical parts. Lift the arm, grab it from the resting position to the start of the record, gently drop it down, and at the end, lift it up, move it back to the resting position, and drop it down again. Or immediately repeat the process if you enabled the repeat switch. Another quite interesting detail, all the wires are connected to the PCB using good old wire wrap. I haven't seen that one in a while. Need to keep them connected as good as possible, I don't have suitable new wires at hand. The tone arm is a very delicate assembly. After all, it has to be moved just by that tiny needle in the record groove without causing wear and tear on the record surface. I was very careful there. The pivots are actually tiny ball bearings that run on points. The audio signal is, typical for that period, not handled within the record player at all. The lines from the pickup coils are directly connected to the RCA plugs on the back. This is when I realized I need to order a phono preamp to test this. The stator of the motor is soldered directly to the PCB, and since there is nothing to clean in between, I leave it as is. Cleaning was simple enough, Just get a bit of dried grease off the mechanical parts. And naturally, recapping the main PCB again. The heavy motor and attached wire loom rat's nest made it impractical to use my PCB holder. Oh well, not as many caps on this one at least. I also tried an LED mod here, more on that later. The switches also needed some TLC. All of them were measuring at several ohms, the tone arm switch even at mega ohms. No good. Reassembly part 1, the tone arm. It has plenty of parts, despite being extremely lightweight. I did give the black parts a new coat of paint and deburred the aluminium center part, cause you could shave with that, if it weren't for the odd shape. Part 2, the inside mechanics. Complicated indeed. It took me a bit of time to realize which parts are connected and interact to achieve the automation. Keep in mind, it has to deal with different sized records and account for edge case scenarios without breaking, like forgetting to release the tone arm. Not to mention that manually starting or stopping should also not prevent the other part from being automated. Oops, I forgot a bracket for the tone arm dampener. Wiggling that in took a bit of time. The RCA plugs were a good match for the tape deck of my last video. Pretty oxidized. I considered cleaning them, but then I took out a decent and currently unused RCA cable and sacrificed it as a replacement. Gold plated even. I just had to write labels for left and right channel on it. Also retrofitted a ground socket. The player did not have one, which struck me as odd. The shielding of the tone arm was directly connected to the braid of one, yes, just one, of the RCA lines. I first tried the start and stop mechanics manually to see if everything moves and nothing is hitting anywhere. Looking good! So turn it right side up and add the platter again. Does it turn on? Yes, yes it does. And here's the moment of truth. Does the auto start work? Yes, it works. Although, I think the needle is dropped off a good deal too far away from the record. Studying the mechanism again revealed that the little adjustment screw next to the tone arm hinge is used to set the drop-off location. I manually turned the mechanism to the point of drop-off and then adjusted until the needle was in the right position for a record. The switch between 33 and 45, well, I can switch between two indistinguishable speeds. The original bulbs were taking a good amount of current to visibly light up. It seems that the residual current of the circuit lights up the LEDs like normal. I tried to add Zener diodes to make the forward voltage of the LEDs higher, and when adding an 8-volt Zener diode and 3 normal ones in series, it finally had the right forward voltage to work. Nice, but I did not buy any Smurf records. It turns out that the switch was showing 33 and 45, but the RPM controller chip was always getting the 45 signal. I could either completely redesign the circuit or revert to the light bulbs for the RPM display, which I did. Maybe upgrade at a later time. This model also has an RPM indicator strobe. When the center pattern appears stationary, the platter rotates at the set RPM. If the pattern moves, it is either too slow or too fast. This is particularly useful when using the pitch control knob. Almost done. But every now and then the auto start would just immediately stop playback again. Weird. Studying the mechanism again. The stop actuator lever is extremely sensitive, so the needle can activate it when it reaches the runout groove. But I had it a bit too sensitive, so it occasionally just fell into place right after the start cycle. I added a bit of grease to make it slightly more sticky, and that did the trick. And one last step now that everything is adjusted again. A new stylus. Yes, I did check for and immediately ordered a new one to go with the player. Special thanks to Carpur and Yamavu for providing some awesome artwork to personalize my record player. As well as Pepper Coyote for allowing me to use a bit of his album as a sample track. Link in the description. And here we go!
These times are frightening, they could make a person sigh. Can't turn around without thinking terror from the sky. An aeroplane just might be headed here right now. And what it's bringing makes an awful big kapow.
Oh no!
That atom bomb might drop on you. And if it does, what do you do? No mushroom cloud will help you out, we'll see you through. What you do is just duck and cover, everything will work out right. Duck and cover, you might make it through the night. Yeah, you only gotta duck and cover, sing your little self a song, and if you do, we'll do it too, so just sing along.
The player will bring much joy to my collection. It has everything that I deem conducive to good playback quality. Direct drive, available replacement stylus, anti-skating and adjustable downforce. As a bonus, it also rests on springs, so it shouldn't pick up any vibrations. I dare say the last one sounds a bit voodoo to me already. And that's it for this episode. I hope you enjoyed my little project. See you next time! I did give the black parts a new paint of coat. Paint of coat? Hi! Paint of coat!